Hello friends, welcome to my second video. You all know, in my first video, I discussed athletic groin pain. We have seen assessment and classification. In this part 2A, we will discuss little bit about rehab protocols and articles. My name is Anuradha Rakhonde Khamkar. I am a sports physiotherapist. This is what I have done so far. I was working with BCCI and National Cricket Academy. I was working at Mumbai Cricket Association as well. I was assistant physiotherapy for Mumbai Cricket Association and IFLI, Pace Bowling Foundation. Right now, I am working as a consultant physiotherapist at Optimal Performance and I own a physiotherapy clinic called Aspire Physiotherapy and Sports Rehab Center. First of all, what all topics we are going to cover in this lecture? Three main topics. First is a traditional and multimodal program rehab. Second, new biomechanical approach. And third is modified Holmich approach. So, when we discuss groin injury, we have seen there are subclassification in groin injury. Adductor related, iliopsoas related, inguinal related, hip related, okay, and others. But if you see the percentage, you know how frequently you see all this injury, you get more of a adductor muscle related injuries. If we see history of the groin pain injury, these two gentlemen, Mr. Penstrom and Peterson, have done research, and they published their article in British Journal of Sports Medicine in 1980. About groin injuries, and they found that out of all groin injuries, 63% you get adductor related injuries, 8% it was iliopsoas related, 4% inguinal, and 5% hip related. So henceforth, whatever I am discussing is all about groin pain adductor related, okay? Because covering every injury, it's impossible in one or two PPTs. I'll make another video for different kind of injuries. So this is a typical rehab, how you know we start our rehab injury. So once you have diagnosed that patient has got an adductor related injury, first goal is to minimize the pain, after that increase the flexibility of that muscle, increase the strength of that muscle. Slowly you progress load and you give them high load and high speed, that is small agility kind of activities. While doing this, you also focus on non-groin exercises, because you're treating one particular part of that athlete body, but you have to maintain full fitness, full body fitness, okay? And you don't want him to lose all the training effect he has been doing before the injury. So you ask them to do all other non-groin injuries exercises also. When we think about the progression, we have a criteria-based progression and we have week, like time-based progression. But it is always individualistic. So assess your athlete, check your athlete completely every time whenever you are progressing to the next stage. After, when your rehab is going well, so next stage is your running and sports function. How you will progress in that? First, you will introduce running movement in control environment, in clinical environment. If that is pain free, you start, you know, slowly running. Ask them to do step up, steps downs. Then you ask them to change the direction in running. And finally, you ask them for, you know, sprint. Increase the effort in your sprinting and start with change in direction. If all these things are pain free, when patient is, you know, clinically pain free, you ask them to continue with their sports training, but in a controlled manner. Load management, and ultimately your aim is to full team training. So this is just a outline for all the rehab protocols. So in this presentation, I'm not gonna give you a fixed recipe, like, you know, once you have got the athletic injury, so day one you have to do this, day two you have to do this, because this is like a spoon feeding and this is not a college lecture. I want you guys to go and read. So whatever I know through reading, I'm encouraging you to read that stuff. So I'm gonna discuss few articles where they have done, you know, experiment with manual therapy, with exercise therapy, with electrotherapy, which was more effective at which level, acute level, a chronic level. Okay, so we'll start with the first experiment or first article. Here what they have done, they have compared two modalities or two exercise approach. First was multimodal treatment program and second was exercise therapy. What they have found, that multimodal treatment program was more effective than only exercise therapy for the treatment of long-standing adductor related groin pain. What they have done, they took a sample size, athletes with the pain at the proximal insertion of the adductor muscle on palpation and resisted adduction for at least 2 months. What they have done, so exercise therapy group, they got a home-based exercise therapy and a structured return to running program with instruction on 3 occasions from a sports physical therapist. What multimodal manual therapy or multimodal treatment program group got? They've got a heat therapy, then Van Den Acker manual therapy, followed by stretching and a return to running program. So this manual therapy is something new to me as well. I tried to search, I haven't got much information on internet about it. What I've got is the only article and explanation in that article. I will discuss that with you in a while. So what was their outcome measures? Primary outcome measure was time to return to full sports participation. How much time they took, the exercise therapy group and multimodal therapy group. And what was the second? Secondary outcome measure was objective outcome score and the visual analog pain score during sports activities. When they have assessed, they have assessed at 0, 6, 16 and 24 weeks. So the follow-up period was for 24 weeks. So a little bit about this manual therapy. This is the only thing I've gotten, you know, on internet. So let me just explain you. Figure 1 is the starting position, athlete lying in a resting position. You can see athlete's left adductor is injured. Therapist is standing on the same side, holding adductor muscle at its proximal end with the same side hand. An ipsilateral hand is holding and balancing that leg's external rotation and knee extension. Okay, so in this position there is a less tension in your adductor muscles. Now excuse me, starting with this position, they are, you know, massaging that adductor muscles in a circular way, and as patient, you know, get comfortable and get relaxed with that muscle, athlete is increasing more external rotation in that hip and knee extension, because that is a, you know, that is increasing tension in that muscles. So start circular massaging with less tension and progress into more tension. I don't know how effective this is in clinical scenario because I have never tried, but I'm eager to try this with my muscle, with my patients who come with the sore muscle after their rehab exercise or their running exercises. Okay, so definitely after this lockdown I'll try this. What they've got result, athlete who received multimodal treatment returned to sports quicker, that is 12.8 weeks, almost 13 weeks as compared to exercise therapy group which took almost 17.3 weeks. There was no difference between the group in objective outcome or VAS. What was the conclusion? The multimodal program result in a significantly quicker return to sports than only exercise therapy plus return to running, but neither treatment was very effective. So you cannot compare that exercise therapy or multimodal therapy is better than each other, but you can definitely see that multimodal can reduce the time to return to sports. Now This PPT is dedicated for Professor Per Holmich. So when I, you know, research for particular injury, I read about all these, you know, scientists or researchers who are presenting multiple papers on different topics, doing research articles, doing research and writing articles for all of us and sharing their knowledge with all of us. So this person has done a lot of research on drawing pin. You can see their research items. It's 245. Currently, he is working in Copenhagen University. He is a sports orthopedic surgeon specialized in groin. And on your left side, there are two YouTube links. First is evaluation of groin pain and diagnosis by Professor Per Holmich himself. And the second is groin assessment. This article, this lecture is also from Professor Per Holmich. So you can go and listen to him. You will get a lot of information about the groin pain. Now, second article is based on his exercise protocol. Effect of Holmich protocol exercise therapy on long-standing adductor related groin pain in athletes. Now, let me give you a quick gist. This person has suggested a model, few models of exercises in 1999. After that, they have been modifying this with the, you know, observations and other research as they are doing it. And now we have some modified Holmich protocol. And this person has, you know, studied effect of this exercise on a groin related pain in a long standing way. Okay, so how long? It should be at least 2 months long. What Holmich has proposed that exercise therapy, you know, is important. And exercise therapy based on what? Isometric and isotonic strengthening. So initially, the previous article, when we see exercise therapy, it was not that specific that what kind of exercises they have given. So that exercise, you can say, was not that effectively assessing what it has to assess. So in this article, they are actually specifying what all exercises they are giving. So, and the exercises are isometric and isotonic exercises and focused on hip abductors and adductor strength and abdominal strength. Okay. While what they're comparing with only passive modalities, that is transverse friction massage, laser therapy, transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation and stretching. So now this is the module. You can go through all these things. You can see there are two modules, module 1 and 2. They have specified what all exercises athlete were doing in what position and how many repetitions and sets. So this is like they are giving you exercise plus dosage. This is very specific. What they have concluded? The exercise therapy according to the Holmich program may be an effective treatment for long standing athletic groin pain. However, more emphasis should be paid to the hip adductor muscles eccentric strength. So those who have read other articles about like hamstring muscles, you know the eccentric strength of muscle is the ultimate goal every therapist want to achieve. Okay, if you want to treat injury or if you want to keep your athlete away from the injury. Okay, now whatever exercises we have seen, module 1 and 2, this is the YouTube link. One physiotherapist is demonstrating all kind of exercises. So you don't need to think about it. You can just go and watch those exercises and start practicing in your. Now, our third and the last article is about biomechanical evaluation. So in this article, the thought process was whenever we are, whenever we are assessing groin pain athlete or when we investigate them for radiology like x-ray or MRI, whatever we are seeing is an injury, is a tissue damage. Okay, but how that tissue got damaged, it is more related to biomechanical aspects. So what they are trying to achieve here, that is there any particular biomechanical, you know, issues or movement issues these athletes are, you know, having underlying factor as to get groin injury. Okay, so this was their main motto. So what they have done, let's just read background. Athletic groin pain is prevalent in sports involving repeated acceleration, deceleration, kicking and change of direction movement. Clinical and radiological examination lacks the ability to assess pathomechanics of acute athletic groin pain. But three-dimensional biomechanical movement analysis may be an important innovation. What was the aim? The primary aim was to describe and analyze the movement used by patient with athletic groin pain during a maximum effort change of direction task. Maximum effort change of direction task means they are sprinting in one direction and they're suddenly changing their direction. The secondary aim was to determine if the specific anatomical diagnosis were related to a distinct movement strategy. So is there a distinct movement strategy putting, you know, this athletes more at the risk of groin injury? What they have done, they've got more than 300 athletes. They analyzed them, structured standard clinical assessment was done. Radiological examinations were performed on all participation. And additionally, each participant performed a task. What task was it? I will just explain you in a simple language. So, athlete have been asked to sprint from point 1 to point B. Now, as soon as athlete reach to point B, athlete has to sharply change the direction of running. Okay? So, if someone is running forward and they have to suddenly turn to their left side once they reach point B. Now, point B is not just a cone placed over there, but there were four split. So, and there were multiple cameras to analyze their each and every biomechanical movement, and everything was on the app to analyze it. So, as soon as athlete starts running, all the cameras started recording their running mechanics, and as soon as they change their direction, force plate recorded all kind of forces they have put, like where was the more force on which leg, how they shift, where they are turning, how their torso is turning, what turning more, okay, where is the weight shift, pelvic shift, everything. So everything they have analyzed, and what they have got after analyzing all the athletes, they have realized that athlete have this three kind of pattern movement. So the knee group, the hip group and the ankle group. What is the knee group? What they are doing? So 40% of the group increase ankle eversion and external rotation. Those who are well versed with the kinematic chain, when you have more of ankle eversion and external rotation, you get a lot of knee internal rotation. Okay, so that is what have been happening in braking and acceleration phase. So this cluster 1 had a high degree of hip internal rotation and the highest proportion of work done at the knee. So that is why they are into a knee group. Now cluster 2, so 20% of the group cluster 2 had the greatest amount of hip flexion. Now here they are working more at their hip throughout the test. During braking and acceleration, this group also had an increased anterior pelvic tilt. So those who are working more from their hip, they also have a more anterior pelvic tilt, and reduced contralateral pelvic drop and reduced ipsilateral pelvic rotation. This group did most of the work at their hip and had a less control over their thorax. So those who were working more from their hip, they were having less control on their thorax. And that is why they are into hip group. Now the third one, the rest, clusters 3 had reduced knee and hip flexion, more contralateral pelvic drop, reduced knee valgus, reduced hip internal rotation, extension and increased hip adduction and contralateral pelvic rotation. This group did most of their work at their ankle. So they have everything reduced and restricted at their knee and their hip. So that is why they are working more on their ankle. So they are into ankle group. This is the picture. If you see, there are three colors, red, gray, blue. So the gray color represent first cluster, that is the knee group. Red one is presenting the hip group and blue one is presenting the ankle group. Now, at which point they have taken this picture is like first the leftmost is at impact, middle is start of the acceleration, and last one, the extreme right, is at the toe off. Okay, so you can see at the gray, knee is flexing more, at red, hip is flexing more, and at blue, ankle is doing all the work. How you conclude from this study? They have identified three distinct movement strategies among the athlete with long-standing groin pain during a maximum effort change of direction task. These movement strategies were not related to clinical assessment finding, but highlighted targets for rehabilitation in response to possible propagative mechanism. So you have to teach them balancing or maintaining or contributing from all the joint when they're propagating, because when they are, using their whole joint to propagate themselves, it is easy. If only one joint is doing a lot of work, it is very difficult and they are, highly prone for. So this was all about part 2A. These are the references. Everything is available on internet, free and full text. You can go and visit. If you like this presentation, then please like and share and subscribe to my channel. Thank you very much for your patience. Thank you very much for listening to me. Very soon I'll be back with my new video, part 2B. Till then, take care, stay safe. Bye-bye.